the organizers for this very nice workshop and giving me this chance to talk about this my recent work. So I'm going to talk about using the neutrino experiment, large volume neutrino experiments for the definite direct detection. And it's based on my recent works and also some ongoing collaborations with microphone and film collaborations. So hopefully we'll have the paper out pretty soon. So I won't waste you any time to convince you that there are dark matters in our universe. We have multiple independent, very solid evidence to show that dark matter indeed exists. And also, we roughly know from our observation that in the current universe, the current energy density, 27% of the current energy density in our universe is taken by the dark matter, and we only know it's probably through its existence, through its gravitational interaction. So it's a huge topic to explore the, what kind of a property and what the identity of dark matter could be. And from the numerical simulation, if nothing weird happens to the dark matter, then we know it follows roughly the NFW problem, at least in the outer region of the galaxy. And in our solar system, it has the energy density about 0.4 GeV per cubic centimeter. And the velocity here is is controlled by the vertical velocity, which is about 10 to the minus 3 speed of light. So for most of the, for all of the dark matter direct detection design so far, they are aiming for look for the dark matter particles flying at the speed as this 10 to the minus 3 speed of light. So decades of efforts has already been focused on the conventional wind dark matter searches, and I'm pretty sure that many of the audience here has already seen this plot for millions of times, that there are three conventional ways to look for dark matters. And this talk, I'm going to focus on the direct detection. So I'm going to only talk about this particular direction. So for the conventional dark matter direct detection, you have the xenon, which is the xenon experiment, which is which has the target mass about outer time. And it's looking for the elastic scattering between dark matter particle and the nucleus in the experiment. And if you consider a lighter mass regime, then you have to change your search strategy. For example, you have to use the other material like superconductor to look for a lighter dark matter like KE dark matter particles. On the other hand, you can instead of moving along the mass direction, you can consider different interactions among dark matter particles and star matter particles. So this will be the key focus of this talk, which I'm going to show you that in certain dark matter models, it's possible to use the large volume neutrino experiment or proton decay experiment to look for dark matter particles. It's based on those two papers and some ongoing collaborations. And the key point here is actually once you can use the neutrino experiment for the dark matter direct detection, then immediately you enhance the target mass from outer time to about million time. So this is a huge enhancement to the for the target mass. Okay, so now let me tell you something about unconventional dark matter models with where you can still have very good theoretical motivations, but people do not pay attention to them for most of the time. So there are two things that I'm going to talk about today. One thing is hopefully I can convince you that there is many kind of well-motivated dark matter models will generically predict that there will be fast-moving dark matter particles in our universe, and we generally call them boosted dark matter particles. And also, the other possibility we consider is that the dark matter particle may have inelastic interaction with the star matter particles instead of just the elastic scattering. So, for example, in this case, this is the so-called semi-annihilation dark matter model. So, in order to stabilize, to make the dark matter stable, you do not impose the Z2 parity. It's possible that you can impose a Z3 parity in order to make the dark matter particle stable. And this particular Z3 symmetry can also very naturally showing up in many UV realization of dark matter models. And so in this case, because of the Z3, so when you have two dark matter particles not annihilate to each other, you have to add in a third particle in the interaction, in this interaction. So it will show up in the final state. And for this particular process, because you convert the mass energy of your dark matter particle to the kinetic energy of the final state particle, so the dark matter particles in the final state will be boosted. Okay. The other possibility is the dark matter model where you have multiple species, where you have two A particles annihilated to two B particles, and if there's a mass hierarchy between A and B, then the B particle will be boosted. And the third possibility is one can consider the inelastic scattering interaction between dark matter particle and star matter particle. For example, here you can imagine that dark star matter particle is a proton, and somehow the dark matter particle carries some kind of anti-baryon number, and this can be very naturally realized in the asymmetric dark matter model. So when the dark matter particle carries anti-baryon number, it can annihilate with proton, convert the proton to bump up a star model of ions and electrons. If this also carry electron number, then this particular problem, this number process, this slide.
While he's fixing that, can I ask something?
Yes.
If you boost it too much, then isn't the dark matter particle lost to the galaxy? The escape velocity is only 540 kilometers.
Precisely. So here, what I'm going to show you later, the third strategy is actually aiming to look for the dark matter being captured by the sun.
Sorry, I didn't get it.
Being captured by the sun.
Okay.
Yeah. So and later you'll see that by looking at the dark matter particle capturing by the sun, you actually reduce the number of parameters that you put into this search. This is a very actually going to give you a very model independent conclusion. Okay, so again for this process, dark matter will annihilate with proton, generate some ions in the final state, and dark matter will flip to its antiparticle. So this is inelastic scattering between dark matter particle and star matter particle. So we call it dark matter induced neutron decay process. Okay, so here is a very quick picture on how to use the neutrino experiment to look for the boosted dark matter particles. So when we say boosted dark matter particles, what we really meant is the dark matter particle has very large kinetic energy. It's moving so fast, whose velocity is actually other one speed of light. So when the dark matter comes into your detector, it can actually see each nucleon in the nucleus and pick up a single proton or neutron out of the nucleus. So this particular process is very similar to the neutrino-neutral current interaction. So that's why we think using the neutrino experiment is possible to look for this kind of particular process. And just to be noted that the target mass in super K or in Dirac collaboration can be about four or five order of magnitude larger than the target mass in the xenon experiment. And here is the small hole in the super K detector, which is how sizable this kind of experiment can be. It's very impressive. The other possibility that we consider in this talk is the dark matter induced neutron decay process, because you know that in your experiment, no matter how well you do the shielding, you never shield your dark matter cosmic background away. So within your experiment, you always have the dark matter flying around in your background, and once for a while, you may possibly find a nucleon to annihilate away, and then trigger the signal. So from the visible sector, from the detector point of view, the whole process is very similar to the proton decay process. That's why we call it dark matter induced neutron decay process, and this is also what we cover in this talk. So let's firstly look at the multiple choices of the neutrino experiments. So the first choice is the super K or hyper K, whose target mass is about megaton. And the detector strategy is using the trunk of ring detector. So it has the very limited energy range, because the proton in the final state cannot be too slow, or else it won't be able to pass the trunk of radiation threshold. So there is a lower limit on how boosted the dark matter can be. And also, the dark matter cannot be so boosted, or else the scattering between dark matter particle and proton will be mostly likely in the very messy channel, which is in the inelastic scattering channel. So instead of kicking out one single proton or a single neutron, you also generate a bunch of ions or other hadrons in the final state. So this is very messy state. It's so-called the multiple ring events in super K. So they are not very good at reconstructing those events. On the other hand, one can move to the microhole or Dirac experiments. The target mass is comparable. At this point, they are using the liquid argon time protection chamber. So in this case, there is almost no lower limit, no lower energy threshold for the detection, because they do not rely on the trunk of radiation anymore. And also, they have a better control on the on the particle ID. So they can actually do a very, very good job to reconstruct the nicely hadronic final states. And the third choice is S-cube. However, the energy threshold currently is about 100 GeV, and it's not clear to us how low they can go for the energy threshold. So we are not going to talk about this S-cube anymore.
5 GeV is the target for people.
Yeah, so I think the 5 GeV, yes. So I do not know whether there is a very nice model we can build that for a boosted dark matter particle that can kick out a proton with 5 GeV only, and because I think for the S-cube it's also not very good to reconstruct the very messy hadronic final state. Okay, just here is just a plot. Sorry, can you see this plot? So here is the plot that I'm going to show you that how much gain you will get by moving from super K to S-cube. So this is the differential distribution of my signal events as a function of the kinetic energy of the final state proton. As you can see here, the blue line is the water trunk-off radiation threshold. So in the super K, you only keep this part of your events. However, you cut away all those big chunk of your signal in the super K. They are not energetic enough to generate any signal in the water. On the other hand, if you move to using the little argon detector, then you can actually keep most of those events. So that this will be a big, huge gain in your signal efficiency. So I don't have time to go over all the details, but here, let me just show you some plots. So you can consider different interactions between dark matter particles and thermal protons by writing down different effective operators. Here are effective operators which where the scattering cross section between star model and product are both go with the velocity square power, velocity zero power, which means no matter whether you boost your dark matter particle or not, the scattering cross section will not be very different. So this is supposed to be a blue region. I don't know why it's done, but in this region, it's now is excluded by the current data of super K by looking at the products in the final state. And if you use more super K data with angular information, then this red line is the ridge. And if you use the hyper K data, this is the yellow line. So the highlight point here is actually in the low mass regime, using the neutrino experiment, you can do a much better job compared to conventional dark matter direct detection. On the other hand, there are also operators where the dark matter nucleon scattering cross section will have enjoy a very large enhancement when the velocity, relative velocity, is large. And in that case, for the whole mass regime, we can beat the dark matter direct detection very well. Okay, so just some quick words about the current collaboration with MicroBone and Dune. So we are trying to write our own depth simulation package to simulate more low energy and more high energy interactions so that we can have a better theoretical prediction on how this event is going to show itself in the liquid argon detector. And now, let me very quickly say something about the dark matter induced nucleon decay process. So the process that we have in mind in our paper that we studied is actually assuming the dark matter particle carry half unit of antibaryon number and half unit of lepton number. So the process is actually proton going to annihilate with the dark matter particle phi. And then the phi will flip to phi bar, and meanwhile, there will be one unit of baryon and one unit of lepton number propagate to the thermal sector. And then you trigger this the decay of the proton to an electron to a positron plus pi zero, for example. So the particular process that we consider in our study is this particular process. And from the visible sector point of view, this is precisely the same as a proton decay channel. And if you look at more details on how SuperK is doing their search, you will find that they actually impose a reconstructed a cut on the reconstructed proton momentum, and also a cut on the reconstructed proton environment mass. So this is our differential distribution of our signal. And as you can see, by imposing those cuts, you actually throw away many of our signal events, and they only keep 5% of them. So, however, we also get into the super K details, and they actually nice enough to show the results in a very comprehensive way. So they have three pairs of plots. So the first pair is the proton decay signal simulation. The second pair is the atmospheric neutrino background simulation. And the third part is the real data. And the small box here is the signal region that we focus on. And the point here is actually, as you can see, within just the neighborhood of this small box is actually also quite empty with respect to the background. So there is a chance that you can further relax the kinetic path of your search so that you can enhance the signal efficiency, for example, from 5% to 20%. And that will help you for the search. So if you stick with the current search strategy of the Super K, then you will find that in for this particular nice benchmark point, then you can start to probe this benchmark point in 2025 in hyper K. However, if you manage to optimize the event selection, then you can actually start to probe the benchmark point by going back to 2007 data using using Super K. So this will be a very good move to go ahead. So now let me conclude. So hopefully I convinced you that the purpose of the neutrino experiments or proton decay experiment can be extended, particularly to look for boosted dark matter particles or the dark matter induced proton decay processes. So those are not conventional dark matter models, however, there are still very strong theoretical motivations behind. Okay, thank you.